Meta just dropped the Quest 3S, a $300 VR headset that is destined to replace the Quest 2 as the go-to device for standalone and PC VR experiences, and adjusted for inflation, it's priced lower than the Quest 2 was at launch in 2020. So how did Meta pack in all of that tech and still come in at a lower price point than the Quest 2? Stick around to find out because I promise you won't be expecting what's inside this thing. Here's a preview thanks to our friends at Lumafield. This CT spin shows you just how complex even cheaper entry-level VR headsets are. Right away, I'm seeing a ton of screws and tiny components, and my first impressions are that this headset disassembly is going to be difficult. Normally, when we're looking at electronics, the first thing we want to access is the battery. Not so with VR. Because all these head straps and cushions touch your face, we need to be able to remove and clean them. A plus for that design. This entry point and those big old Fresnel lenses look very familiar, and they should. The setup, along with the manual IPD adjustment, is identical to what we saw in the Quest 2. Fresnel lenses are cheaper to make and use less computing power than the pancake lenses in devices like the Quest 3, freeing up resources and helping lower the price point of the device. Just like the Quest 2, this plastic faceplate is a royal pain to remove. There's a trick to it though, you need to slide a pick across the bottom and dislodge the super stubborn clips on each outer edge. While I'm struggling with this, note the lack of a proximity sensor between the lenses. The Quest 2 has one, it's used to detect when you take off the headset so the screen can be turned off to save battery power. Unfortunately, those sensors were getting exposed to moisture because some of you all sweat way too hard. That was causing short circuits that were literally melting the plastic and the sensor all in one go. Yikes. Probably for the best that it's gone. After breaking two spudgers and a pick, I finally force the side clips out of the way and off comes the faceplate cover. Now we can see the Fresnel lenses up close, which, to my utter surprise, I find are 100% identical in form to the Quest 2 lenses, right down to the IPD adjusting mechanism. This is really cool. There are a lot of broken Quest 2s out there and it's great to be able to salvage components from those broken headsets to fix the latest iteration of the hardware. We can also see a hint of the battery pack sitting above the optical stack. No hint of that IR proximity sensor, it's definitely gone. Taking a tip from our Quest 2 disassembly, we have several screws to undo all around the lowest corners of the interior. For this, I need to break out my fixed blade driver to reach those deeper recesses. With all the screws out, that faceplate pops away, revealing that there's a lot that's changed in here. The fan cowl is now embedded all the way around the outer edge of the frame, and we also now have two new clusters of sensors, each comprising of an IR sensor, tracking camera, and color pass-through camera. On that same bracket, we now have the wireless antenna, a component that sits by itself on a similar bracket in the Quest 2. The disassembly process gets a smidgen simpler here. Because the camera's moved from the outer edge to that lower bracket, there are fewer delicate flex cables to work around. That does mean, though, that we have to pay our dues up front. This is still a relatively complicated device to disassemble with lots of components to keep track of. To remove that sensor and antenna assembly, I first need to remove the securing bracket sitting on either side of the fan cowl. Each bracket hides some press connectors and speaker cables along with the odd coax antenna cable. All of these cables feel sturdier than those in the Quest 2. Their rigidity gives me some confidence that they won't tear with the slightest amount of pressure. Now that I have the sensor assembly out, I'm going to turn my attention to that single LED indicator sitting on the fan cowling. I need to unstick it before I can remove the fan assembly. With the fan removed, I can see that even the Quest 3S mainboard is similar in dimension to the Quest 2's, But there's a major repairability improvement here. There are far fewer cables running behind this board, something that makes the reassembly of the Quest 2 a bit of a chore. Once the display connector is off, I'm free to remove the standoff screws and a couple of the heatsink and support screws, and the main board comes away. Removing the heatsink gives us a good look at that Qualcomm Snapdragon XR2 Gen 2 processor, the same one found in the Quest 3. Built on a 4nm node, this SoC gives the Quest 3S a total of 8GB of RAM to work with, and the ability to support the additional tracking sensors and color pass-through cameras. I've made some surprisingly quick progress so far. Removing some outer support screws does free up the entire central column consisting of the optical stack and the LCD panel. It also gives me access to the battery pack, a similarly shaped outer case with a substantially larger capacity. At a rated 17.06 watt-hours, the Quest 3S has a 22% larger battery than the identically shaped 14 watt-hour battery found in the Quest 2. Unfortunately, the batteries are not cross-compatible because the press connectors are different designs. That's a missed opportunity if you ask me. It's time to take a closer look at that optical stack by removing the plastic nubbins and metal tabs securing each lens to the sliding mechanism. It's possible to glue these brackets back in place, but it's another missed opportunity. These brackets should have been secured with screws. As I mentioned before, the Fresnel lenses are identical to the ones used in the Quest 2, allowing Meta the ability to capitalize on existing manufacturing lines to save costs. It's also good for the planet since broken Quest 2s can be used for spare parts on the Quest 3S. It's a win-win for everyone. That leaves the display panel, which, just like the Quest 2, is a single LCD spreading across both eyes. And just like the Quest 2 panel, there's stretch release adhesive holding this panel in place with tabs to make panel removal easier. It's not the easiest adhesive to deal with, but the pull tabs do work. Less so when they're old and crusty, but that's a whole other story. It's worth mentioning that this panel is fully compatible with the Quest 2, meaning that the Quest 2 panel is also compatible with the Quest 3S. Again, this will be a boon for repairs. One of the pricier failure points on these headsets is the LCD panel. This has been a very interesting disassembly. For all intents and purposes, we found a Quest 2 inside the Quest 3S. And not that there's anything wrong with that, but you wouldn't be far off the mark if you called this thing a Quest 2 Pro. On the repairability front, we definitely found some interesting changes, including cross-compatible components and a marginally easier disassembly process. There's still lots of room for improvement, with the lens stack in particular needing some attention to refine the design for repairability. And there honestly is no reason why the battery connectors should be different between the Quest 2 and the Quest 3S. Bearing all that in mind, I feel that Meta adopted some good design choices by reusing parts from the obsolete Quest 2 inside the Quest 3S, but I can't shake the feeling that it was done for financial gain rather than altruistic intentions. Perhaps the next generation of devices will convince me otherwise.